When a supersonic flow encounters a concave corner, we know that this causes the flow to turn into itself. This leads to the formation of an oblique shock. But what if the flow encountered a convex corner? In this case, the supersonic flow would effectively be turning away from itself. This interaction leads to the formation of expansion waves. And in this lesson, we will try to understand the physics behind it. So let's get started. Expansion waves are formed when a supersonic flow turns in such a way that it expands in the direction of the flow. This is exactly opposite of the situation in which the flow turns into itself, leading to the formation of oblique shocks. As can be seen in this Mach number contour plot, when a Mach 2.5 flow encounters this cone, the leading edge essentially acts as a concave corner. We can see that this encounter results in the formation of an oblique shock. Across the shock, the Mach number decreases, that is, the flow decelerates, and the static flow properties increase. Now, as the flow moves further downstream, it encounters a convex corner. This creates a system of expansion waves. As the flow expands, the Mach number of the flow increases. That is, the flow accelerates, and the static flow properties decrease. So if you think about it, expansion waves are basically the opposite of oblique shocks. Let's look at the contour plot again. Do you see anything strikingly different between the oblique shock and the expansion wave? Did you notice that unlike a shock, expansion region is continuous and the properties vary relatively smoothly and continuously, but without any abrupt changes? For an abrupt corner, as shown here, a group of expansion Mach waves is formed such that the flow turns and becomes parallel to the downstream wall. Expansion waves are often called expansion fans. Each line in the expansion fan represents a line of constant properties. In fact, there are infinite number of waves originating from this corner, and each wave turns the flow by an infinitesimal amount and accelerates the flow by an infinitesimal amount as well. This leads to a differential model. Now that we have some physical understanding of expansion waves, let us try to formulate it by deriving the governing equations for a planar expansion wave. Consider a single Mach wave for a flow being turned through a differential angle d theta. From geometric and trigonometric considerations, we can get the following equation. Now for a small d theta, this can be simplified to the following expression. If we now use Taylor series expansion up to the first order term, we use the relationship between the Mach angle and the Mach number of the given Mach wave, we can get the Prandtl-Meyer equation. This is a differential equation relating the change in the flow angle d theta to the corresponding change in the flow velocity dv as the flow turns around this corner. Keep in mind that this equation was derived strictly on the basis of geometric reasoning and the definition of the Mach wave, and therefore it is a general equation, which means it can be applied to ideal gases, real gases, or even chemically reacting gases. A solution for the expansion wave can be obtained by integrating this equation. We can simplify this to obtain an explicit expression for an ideal gas by using these relations. The resulting equation is called the Prandtl-Meyer function and is represented using the Greek symbol nu. Using this function, we can express the deflection angle theta 2 as the difference of Prandtl-Meyer functions corresponding to m2 and m1. We can now calculate the flow properties across a Prandtl-Meyer expansion wave by following these steps. First, we determine nu m1 from the Prandtl-Meyer function using the known upstream Mach value of m1. Since we know the turning angle θ2, we can then calculate nu of m2 from this equation. Once we have nu m2, we can calculate m2, that is the Mach number downstream from the expansion fan, using Prandtl-Meyer function. One thing to keep in mind here is that the calculation of Mach number from nu would require inversion of this nonlinear equation. And therefore, this calculation is usually carried out using a numerical technique. The Mach number can also be obtained from tabulated or plotted representation of nu versus m. Since the expansion wave is assumed to be isentropic, the total pressure and the total temperature are conserved across the expansion. And thus, we can calculate their static values downstream of the expansion using these relations. As we had discussed earlier, the Prandtl-Meyer function was derived using a definition of a Mach wave and geometric considerations. We never actually enforced any condition that explicitly stated that the flow has to be expanding. And therefore, the Prandtl-Meyer function holds in all situations where the flow is turning isentropically through an envelope of Mach waves, irrespective of whether the flow is expanding or compressing. When we discussed oblique shocks, we did consider a situation of supersonic flow compression through an envelope of Mach waves over a curved corner, but we did not offer any theory at that time. Well, it turns out that the near wall compression flow across a Mach wave fan can be analyzed using the same Prandtl-Meyer function approach for expansion waves, but with the opposite sign as shown here. Keep in mind that this analysis is limited to the near wall region where the envelope Mach waves exist. Further away from the wall, these Mach waves coalesce into an oblique shock, and the oblique shock theory needs to be applied. Before we wrap up this lesson, let us look at a comparison of expansion and compression wave analysis. Let us consider two cases where supersonic flow at Mach equals 2 encounters a 10 degree expansion and a 10 degree compression respectively. Now, based on the incoming Mach number, we get a new M1 of 26.38 for both the cases. Depending on whether the flow encounters an expansion or a compression of θ2 equals 10 degrees, we get new M2 of 36.38 degrees for expansion and 16.38 degrees for compression. Using this, we can see that the resultant Mach number M2 becomes 2.386 after 10 degree expansion and 1.652 after 10 degree compression. With that, let's wrap up this lesson.